Hello and welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to a new edition of the Daily Debate. In tonight's show, we're going to be talking about the Syrian crisis, the ongoing developments in Syria. Now, recently, the Syrian rebels actually lost all northern strongholds in the east of Aleppo. Also, domestically, Egypt has refuted reports that it has any military presence in Syria, taking part of all in all the developments taking place. And joining us here in the studio to shed more light on the Syrian file, we're joined in the studio by Ambassador Mohammed Shazly, the member of the Egyptian Council for Foreign Affairs. We're also joined by Dr. Mohammed Abdul Halim, the political analyst. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us this evening.
Pleasure. Pleasure.
Ladies and gentlemen, before we start our discussion, let's check out this report regarding Egypt refuting all the reports claiming that there is any Egyptian military presence in Syria, and we'll be right back.
Egypt refuted media reports that it had a military presence in Syria, with the foreign ministry confirming that Egypt does not intervene in the internal affairs of other countries, adding that such an intervention would require public legal measures. The statement did not refer to any specific media outlets behind the claims. The ministry said in a statement that those claims only existed in the imagination of those who promoted them. The statement was referring to a report on the Lebanese newspaper Safir, which said that 18 Egyptian Air Force pilots had been deployed on a military base in the Syrian central province of Hama. The report claimed that it was unclear whether the pilots were taking part in any military operations. Citing sources close to the operation, Safir reported that Cairo would deploy a large contingent of troops to Syria in late January of 2017 to participate in operations not limited to air support at the Hama Air Base. Some sources described the Egyptian flight crews as taking over the cockpits of Russian attack Rekhonov Ka-52 helicopters, with which they were familiar, having trained on them since the end of 2015. Others say that the Egyptian airmen flew those helicopters from Egypt to Syria over the eastern Mediterranean. There is also a claim that their arrival was preceded by a preliminary inspection of the Syrian front lines by two major generals from the Egyptian General Staff Operations Division, who later submitted their recommendations to the Egyptian president. The report by the newspaper came days after President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi expressed support for the Syrian military during an interview with a Portuguese broadcaster. Responding to a question on whether Egypt would contemplate a UN peacekeeping role in Syria, Sisi said that Egypt's priority is to support national armies, for example, in Libya, to assert control over Libyan territories and deal with terrorist elements. He said Cairo's stance is to respect the will of the Syrian people and that a political solution to the Syrian crisis is the most suitable way to seriously deal with terrorist groups and disarm them.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Starting off our discussion right away, Ambassador Shazly, now Egypt has refuted reports that there is any Egyptian military presence in Syria. First off, whom do you think would be behind promoting such false news? I mean, Arab media has reported that there is Egyptian military presence in Syria. The government, the Egyptian government, has refuted and denied these reports. Whose interests would it be for claiming that Egypt has any presence, military presence in Syria?
I personally don't think that this is the issue. The issue is that here is an Arab country that has watched silently American forces engaged in Syria, Russian forces engaged in Syria, Turkish forces engaged in Syria, European forces. We've had, you know, we've learned from the media some time ago that Belgian aircraft were operation in Syria. I mean, this is never in the history of the Arab world have so much foreign forces intervened in Arab territory. And they're a country that has acquiesced to all this intervention from foreign countries, Iran, Turkey, the Europeans, the Americans, the Israelis. And they are furious over claiming that Egyptian forces are engaged in Syria. I mean, this is the problem, not who is behind it, but the mentality where you feel threatened and betrayed by the participation of Arab forces in an Arab country, whereas you acquiesce to the participation of all these other armed forces in Syria.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dr. Abdul Halim, now Ambassador Shazly raised a very important point. There is a lot of international foreign presence in Syria. However, the Arab League and all the Arab countries have been numerously criticized for their lack of participation, actually taking practical and concrete steps in trying to solve the Syrian crisis. Why do you feel that it is probably very frowned upon if an Arab country would actually take some sort of serious steps in Syria?
Right. I mean, the Syrian issue actually is very much crucial. It wouldn't seem to be as it might seem in the first instance, actually, as simple as that. It's absolutely complicated, as much as our dear friend, Ambassador Mr. Shazly, said that it seems to be a territory that is very much abided by a large number of forces, foreign forces, American on the one hand, trying to establish its political as well as military interests in some areas, in much of the same way that the Russian troops, in the meantime, are looking after their own interests in Aleppo and other districts, actually, in Syria. And there is the third participation on the part of the Turkish government with the view of cancelling or abolishing, as you might have said, the establishment of the Kurdish state. So as such, the scene would seem to be dismantled and very much crucial, actually, for any Arab country to intervene. This is from one point of view. From another point of view, as our dear friend also has aptly said, and rightly said so, that a little country might be behind the scene, pushing all these things and all these wars of propaganda. The little dots on the map, which is Qatar, actually, might behind the scene here every now and again, pushing all these war of propaganda, actually, trying to initiate a sort of an interference on the Egyptian military. But this is far from being so, far from being right, actually. We've got a resourceful and very much intelligent political leadership that knows the ins and the outs of the political scene as well as the military territory in Syria. Any sort of advancement, any sort of, you know, military attack in any conceivable respect on our own, you know, armed forces would seem to be a great fault. And I think that our own military political leadership actually is quite apt to know the fact that this is far from being true. We've got all these resourceful means and all the, you know, might the political advances on our own political leadership that might try every now and again to interfere politically, peacefully, introducing, as you might have said, what you might call certain solutions, trying to not to widen the gap between all these forces and all these. But behind the scene, actually, there is one major hidden agenda and one major problematic situation that a large number of political analysts might not be quite aware of, which is the geographical expansion of the Israeli land to the Golan Heights is one of the hidden agendas, actually, of the Israeli troops. The only part and the only party that would seem to be quite benefiting from all these dismantling tassels and all these struggling opponent forces, actually, is Israel, actually. Geographically now, I mean, it would seem to be immediately after the sort of the devastation of the fire of a large part of Israel. It may be in a very bad need, actually, to expand it geographically, to try to expand the land just by way of, you know, I mean, representing and sending a large number of the refugees, finding the fact that it would seem to be a bit difficult, actually, to try to make a large number of immigrants actually to go to Sinai, you know, after the sort of the attack of our own armed forces and that process of purifying Sinai out of all the militant groups and all those extremists and all those Muslim brothers, I would say, or terrorist brothers or terrorist brotherhood. So, I mean, the situation, as it might have said at the very beginning, is very much crucial, very much complicated, actually. And the agenda would seem to be quite in a place that wouldn't, you know, I mean, make any sort of very much resourceful political leadership to interfere in any conceivable respect. Despite the fact that every now and again we might have heard of a certain truce, of a certain declaration of Aleppo as a non-flying zone, as a non-armed zone, mm-hmm. as, you know, as a peaceful land, but quite for a short period of time, actually.
Yes.
The struggle is always continuing even now and again. And the only, you know, and the sole benefactor at the end of the day is Israel at the mm-hmm. end of the day, out of all this political game.
Yes. Well, Ambassador Shazly, the Arab League and all the Arab countries have been criticized for not really taking big, clear steps in solving the Syrian crisis. And at the same time, everyone's quite hesitant to interfere with any sort of presence within the country. We're all talking about finding diplomatic and political solutions, which is always the best way possible. However, that hasn't really achieved much over the past few years. So, what is the right thing to do to have actual presence in Syria by the Arab countries, not just Egypt, but the majority or most of the Arab countries actually taking part hands-on in Syria? Or should we just take a step back and call for a lot of political and diplomatic solutions and watch many foreign parties taking real actual practical steps in Syria?
I mean, we are not still going to take a mm-hmm. step back. We have taken already 100 steps back. Mm-hmm. And we have seen all the regional and international powers active in Syria. The problem with the Arabs is that there is, in reality, there is no Arab League. I mean, the Arab League is a building and an organization where some diplomats are taking very lucrative salaries. Mm-hmm. But there is no Arab agenda. There is no Arab strategy. Mm-hmm. There is no Arab goodwill towards one another. I mean, the problem is that every Arab country now is entrenching itself against other Arab countries. Mm-hmm. This, I mean, is catastrophic. We have completely left the scene. And now everybody else is active on Syrian territories, on Iraqi territories, on Libyan territories, on Yemeni territories, mm-hmm. and the Arabs are completely out of the scene in building the future of their countries and preserving the integrity of their lands. I mean, we can't say that the Arab League is not doing anything, because there, in reality, there is no Arab League.
Yes.
There are a group of ambassadors who sit on a table every now and then and declare declarations which are never implemented. We have had, Egypt has proposed an Arab force in accordance with the Arab League constitution, mm-hmm. and in accordance with the joint defense pact between the Arabs, and this has been sabotaged.
Yes.
Because other countries want to take the lead.
Yes. Well, Dr. Abdul Halim, now you've mentioned the benefactor, really, of what's going on is Israel, and you also mentioned Qatar playing a role in spreading all these rumors. Now, the Lebanese daily, As-Safir, actually, last week reported that Cairo sent a military unit of 18 pilots to an airbase in the western central city of Hama earlier in November. Now, Lebanon, for instance, is a country that has had problems for quite some time. And recently, they took many steps forwards. They elected a new president. Egypt supported the election of actually having a new president and congratulated all the political figures and parties in Lebanon. Now, why would a Lebanese daily actually come out with a report such as that? If it's not Israel, it's not Qatar, why is it coming from Lebanon?
Well, perhaps, I mean, to outward seeming, Lebanon would seem to be a very much unified country, as you might have said. Getting a president in the mm-hmm. first instance, but into the inside of the infrastructure of the Lebanese lands, you find that they are very much divided among one another. They do not have what you might call an agreement or a consensus of opinion. They are divided among the, you know, the Christians, the Muslims, the Shia and the Sunni. And, you know, a large number of the Hamas figures are there, actually, behind the scenes, doing some conspiracies, initiating their own agendas every now and again. But in the meantime, the sole role that is being played by Lebanon is not that great one, indeed, as much as other Arab countries that I have mentioned at the very beginning, as much as Qatar. Despite the fact that geographical expansion of Qatar is very much minimized to a small dot on the map, actually. But the sort of the force that is proacting, particularly the rumors that had been initiated a couple of days ago about our own Egyptian armies and about, you know, I mean, the sort of the force behind the recruitment of all those individuals and all those Egyptian citizens into an army. This is a universal fact. This is an international phenomenon. Each single individual citizen that is belonging to a certain country would have immediately after graduation served for a couple of years, for 3 years actually, just by way of paying the tribute and the price of being one of the individuals of that dear land. This is something quite natural. This is something quite, you know, I mean, accented on and upon and have agreed on and upon. But the fact that no matter how the allegations, no matter how the rumors that Qatar would do and spread here, there and everywhere, just by way of minimizing the infrastructure of the Egyptian armed forces, just by way of weakening, actually, you know, our own belief in our own political leadership, as much as the face of our own soldiers and armed forces at the end of the day. It would come to no avail at the end of the day, because each single individual house in Egypt would get a soldier, a man that is serving, actually, in the Egyptian army. So all these things would come to no avail. The only part that would seem to be losing at the end of the day is Qatar, losing its own identity, if it has got any, its own fixed personality, if there is any. And inshallah, up till the very day of our own life, our own Egyptian armed forces will be glorified, respected, and highly evaluated in the eyes of almost every single individual Egyptian citizen, no matter how long or
Yes. Ambassador Shazly, now a lot of talk has been regarding either supporting and backing Syrian President Bashar al-Assad or not, whether the parties already taking part or involved in Syria militarily or in the Arab world. Now, President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi has actually expressed support for the Syrian President Bashar al-Assad, describing him as the Syrian president who is best positioned to combat terrorism and restore stability in Syria. How do you weigh the president's support and backing for Bashar al-Assad, and how does that weigh within the Arab countries and states?
I don't think the issue is Bashar al-Assad. I mean, it is the great error that is being made is should Bashar al-Assad stay or should Bashar al-Assad go? The issue is should Syria stay as a unified country? Should Syria remain in history or should Syria dissolve? This is the issue. I mean, the option that we have now is, even if it is the worst option, but it is the only option available. We have now a civil war, people who have supposedly risen against a dictator, against a tyrant, against a bad ruler. Whether this is true or not, I'm not going to evaluate it. But those who have risen against him have even failed to remain united. They are fighting one another. Their allegiance is not to Syria. Their allegiance are to regional and international powers. They do not represent the Syrian people as much as they represent these powers. So this is the real tragedy. I mean, if you want Bashar al-Assad to go, what is the option? What other choice do we have to fill the vacuum in Syria when Bashar al-Assad goes? We have seen that the vacuum created in Iraq after Saddam Hussein, what it has done to Iraq. Mm-hmm. We have seen what the vacuum that has occurred after the fall of Gaddafi in Libya has led Libya to. And we are trying our best to prevent this catastrophe that has already mm-hmm. hit Syria. We are trying to mitigate the effects of this tragedy. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, even the Arab countries, they have their own agendas that collide with one another, that do not coincide with them, that do not represent the benefit of Syria or of the Arab world.
Dr. Abdul Halim, now the Syrian Foreign Minister Walid al-Muallim has actually he actually spoke about the normalization of political relations between Egypt and Syria, describing it that it would be a small leap to actually a small leap away. He was quite hopeful of actually normalizing these relations now if Cairo and Damascus normalize the political relations, getting them back on track to as they were years before. How do you feel this could change the political relations and the dynamics between Egypt and Syria regarding what's happening there now, if it's going to change anything?
Right, as you might have said rightly now, that Syria and Egypt had been at one stage mm-hmm. of the history, just one unified land, one unified country, under the leadership of two very much intimate dear brothers, dear mm-hmm. presidents, I would say, you know, at one stage. And I think the sense of popularity and the sense of the crucial identification between the Syrian people and the Egyptian population on the one hand mm-hmm. is still there. I mean, we are very much tied to one another. And so far as we do have a large number of Syrian brothers in here in Egypt, very much abiding all these large cities, doing very much remunerative jobs and restaurants and pizzerias, they are striking a very good example of how being the best among the rest, of how they would turn the sort of the tragedy that they have had at what stage of their own life into a very remunerative and a very prosperous story of success. More than 5 million Syrians are mm-hmm. still there in here, 6th of October, city in Cairo and Alexandria and Sharqiyya, here, there, and everywhere. It's a clear testimony to the fact that we are very much unified. Perhaps Egypt would come as the first country among all the Arab countries, actually, that would abide a large number of Syrian brothers, and in the meantime, treating them as much as an ordinary individual citizen of Egypt, maybe, or is. So this is a great, clarification and testimony to the fact that we are very much unified with each other. We are not behind the scene. We are not very far away, either geographically or even historically, from Damascus. We are being part and parcel of the infrastructure of the Damascus land. Mm-hmm. But I think the time is not coming yet. It is in the right time, actually, to interfere. It's the right time to take a decision at the moment, actually. As our own dear friend, Ambassador Mr. Mohammed Shazly said, that it's a very crucial landfall of a large number of tussling forces, each of which would propagate its own right for the part of the cake. But at the end of the day, Egypt is endorsing the scene, criticizing, selecting, and rejecting the situations, as much as choosing the right time to interfere. But mm-hmm. I think that the right time hasn't come yet, mm-hmm. but it would be yes. at one stage.
Ambassador Shazly, now looking at the Syrian situation, the United States administration has been a big player in what's going on there. Now, the new president-elect, Donald Trump, he promised a lot of a reshuffling within Middle East affairs. Do you feel that he will change the stakes or change the policies being implemented regarding the Syrian file as opposed to his predecessor, Barack Obama?
The United States is a country of institutions. However powerful the office of the president is, the president has liberty to maneuver in a very limited and narrow scope. Mm-hmm. He is governed by Congress, he is governed by the Senate, he is governed by the media, by the CIA, by the pressure groups, by big business, by all over. He cannot change drastically the policy of the United States anywhere in the world. Tactically, there are going to be some changes, but these changes, in the end, they're going to be in the interest of the United States, not in the interest of the Arab world, not in the interest of Syria. I mean, the big hullabaloo that has erupted in the Arab countries when Donald Trump won the elections, I really can't understand this. I can't understand the mentality of those who are applauding a man who says, I will prevent Muslims from coming into the United States. He has said derogatory remarks on women. He has said derogatory remarks on Latinos. He has said derogatory remarks on African Americans. He is a racist par excellence. I mean, how can we hope that such a man is going to serve our interests and have an agenda compatible with our agenda? I mean, this, I mean, I can't understand the mentality of people who think that way. In the end, you know, for, I'm not a young man, but I have been following American elections for at least 50 years. And every elections, we are, you know, putting our trust in one of the candidates, and then we are completely disappointed. So long as we are going to leave our destiny to be designed by exterior forces, whether it is Americans, Democrats, or Republicans, whether it is Russians, the Soviet Union, or the Russian Federation, whether it is the Europeans, whether it is the Chinese, who people now are, you know, trying to embrace the China as a savior from. Nobody is going to be our savior. If we are not going to be our saviors, we will never be saved.
Well, talking about the institutions there, would it be in the best interest of the American institutions for the policies to change in Syria and in the Middle East in general, or do you think it would be in their interest to stay the same?
I don't think it is in the interest of anybody for the politics to stay the same, because, I mean, for how many years now we've been having bloodshed, we've having destruction, we've having jockeying for power between the major powers. So I don't think it is in the interest of anybody for these politics to continue. But they're going to change, yes. But in what direction? Yes. Trump seems to be, you know, giving a friendly hand to Putin.
Yes.
He wants to cooperate more with the Russians. This is, I mean, the game. The big powers are distributing the spoils between themselves without regard to, I mean, we have not learned the lessons of history. In the early 20th century, we have Mustafa Kemal going to France and seeking its support against Britain in their occupation at the time when France was occupying Algeria and committing atrocities there. I mean, we haven't learned this lesson until now. All of, you know, the countries that have risen have depended on themselves, have depended on their people, on their government, on their resources.
Yes. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the rebels in Syria, their hold on Aleppo seems to be collapsing with the advances of the Syrian troops. Let's check out this report and we'll be right back.
Syria's rebels lost all of the northern neighborhoods of their stronghold in East Aleppo as the army gained significant ground in its offensive to recapture the entire city. On Monday, government forces seized the Sahur, Haidariya and Sheikh Khodra districts, whilst Kurdish fighters took the Sheikh Faris neighborhood. From rebels, pro-government troops expanded their hold on vital sections of eastern Aleppo. Approximately 2 hours after announcing the capture of the Haidariya neighborhood, the Syrian Arab army broke through the Fatah Halab's front lines at Sahur, resulting in the complete seizure of the strategic district. It had seized a key neighborhood on the outskirts of the city's eastern flank 13 days into an all-out government offensive to finish off the rebels. The takeover carried symbolic weight. The neighborhood and the housing district was the first to fall to the rebels in 2012. Syrian government troops were able to consolidate their control on the nearby neighborhoods. The troops also breached three adjacent neighborhoods before establishing fire control over the Helak and Sahur districts, which lie on the front line, separating rebel areas from government-controlled parts of western Aleppo. The move effectively split the rebel enclave in two, whilst the ferocious rocket barrage pummeled other opposition areas near the center of the city. Even as troops advance from the east, the Otz Brigade, a Palestinian paramilitary group fighting alongside the government in Aleppo, advanced on the besieged rebels' northeastern flank. The Syrian Observatory for Human Rights acknowledged the government's progress. In recent months, a large-scale campaign backed by Russian air power and thousands of Shiite militiamen from Lebanon, Iraq, Iran and Afghanistan established a punishing siege of the estimated 250,000 residents living in the rebel enclave.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Now, Dr. Abdul Halim, how do you evaluate or how do you read the Syrian government's advance in Aleppo city, really pushing aside the rebels from the northern strongholds and northern neighborhoods in Aleppo? Are you surprised by that? Is this something that the whole world should have expected, for the Syrian government troops to actually make these quite significant advances recently?
Well, it's part of the political game and the military game. Sometimes in, sometimes out. Perhaps at other instance, you might find that all these governmental troops, you know, are achieving what you might call a great deal of success and military achievement. At another, they would deteriorate and they would go back every now and again. It's a sort of hidden agenda that had been planned by the American as well as the Jewish troops. The fact that they are planning every now and again to devastate, as I must have said at the very beginning, the infrastructure of the Syrian land, side by side with the armed forces of Damascus. This is one fact at one level. At another, the Turkish advancements within the land is very much crucial. The fact that side by side behind the curtains, the Turkish army would seem to be quite working in taciturn agreements with respect to the American troops side by side with the Russian. That's why, I mean, I wouldn't suggest that sort of advancement on the part of the governmental forces of Syria is a testimony to the great deal of success. Nor it would be, you know, an end of the line or a finalization of the whole thing. Still, there is a hidden agenda behind the curtains. A large number of malicious advancements would be there even now and again till you understand, the world would put a final point or at the end of the whole tale. Behind the scene, the Syrians are very much unified and very much behind their own leader, Bashar al-Assad. But Bashar al-Assad is not the target, is not actually the right man to be selected or rejected. He's not, he's playing the role of being a victim. He's very much victimized, being a puppet at the hands of all these superpowers. They could have assassinated him in the first instance a couple of years ago, or about 3 years ago. But I think that the prolonging of his own existence as a life, as a puppet, as a mere marionette, at the hands of all these superpowers, is in the interests of Israel as much as these superpowers, to each of which would claim its own right to take the piece of the cake at the end of the day. Yes. So we shouldn't be very much optimistic by any sort of very much short-lived or temporary success or advancement on the governmental forces belonging to Bashar al-Assad. We should wait and see, actually, till the whole thing will be finalized at one stage, at a certain time, in a certain place. Yes.
Ambassador Shazly, now, among the opposition groups in Syria, there are many divisions. They disagree about many things. However, little common ground that they have is knowing that Aleppo is a big step. Taking control of Aleppo is a big step to actually overthrow President Bashar al-Assad. Now that the government troops have almost two-thirds of Aleppo, do you feel that if things go relatively the same way they are going now, even though there might be a few hiccups, as Dr. Abdul Halim mentioned, do you feel that this means probably the end of the opposition groups and the victory of Bashar al-Assad. Do you feel that even if they control Aleppo, this doesn't mean that President Assad will actually still be in power? Do you think that he will have control and then maybe strike some sort of a consensus, a government that is formed out of opposition groups and government forces? Do you feel that maybe the Syrian, it would be in the best interest for the international community and the international parties taking part in the Syrian crisis that they would actually want to keep Bashar al-Assad in place?
You said, you know, is this the end of the opposition groups? I don't think there was a beginning to the opposition groups in the first place. I mean, I can't call those fighting against Bashar al-Assad as an opposition group because they are not one group. The United Nations is going to hold a meeting on Syria, I think the beginning of next month. And Dimas Tura was saying that the parties that are going to attend are not going to sit with one another. He is going to sit with every faction alone behind closed doors. They don't even want to sit together against their common opponent. What kind of opposition is this? And this is because, as I told you at the very beginning, that they are not Syrian opposition. These are fronts for regional and international powers. Every faction is acting and being financed and supported by a certain regional or international force. You cannot call this a legitimate opposition. They are, I think, more like mercenaries. And you cannot really expect such groups to be working for the benefit of Syria. They do not even want to sit together. How will they, if they were successful in overthrowing Assad, how will they deal with one another to build the country once more? I mean, the point is not the overthrow of Assad. The point is to save Syria from the butchery that is going on, from the destruction that is going on, and keep it as a single entity. If you do not want to sit with your so-called allies who are forming the opposition against the common enemy, how will you act after the overthrow of this enemy? They will turn against one another and continue the mayhem and destruction that is going on.
Then what should we expect from out of that UN meeting? Because still a lot of people are criticizing the UN as an institution the same way they are criticizing the Arab League. It's basically an international institution where everybody shows up, they condemn what's all the bad things that are taking place, calling for many declarations, but nothing really materializes in the end.
I will tell you what I think of this meeting. This meeting is, those who are going to be invited are going to be invited by the United Nations without consulting with any of the Arab forces, without consulting with the Arab League. Because, as I told you, there is, in actuality, there is no Arab League. So, those who are invited will not be convening for the sake of Syria. They will be convening. Let us face reality. The United Nations is the Security Council. The Security Council is the five permanent members who each of them has their agenda in Syria. So those who are going to be invited, and those who are going to convene, will be representing the interests of these countries rather than representing the interests of the Syrian people or of the Arab people.
Well, Dr. Abdul Halim, you mentioned that even if the scenario was President Bashar al-Assad stays in power, a lot of other countries and a lot of other international influences would like to have him in place to be manipulated or at least still have some sort of control over the country. Does that mean that even if the president is still there, the sovereignty of Syria will still be in question and there will always be some sort of international interference in the country even after this conflict ends after many years of bloodshed?
Well, it will end at some stages, I might have said, but it will end sooner or later, but not in the interests of the Syrian people, not in the interests of all the Arab countries, actually, because they do not have the right to participate. They do not right even actually to say yes or no, or even to get in, actually, to put an end for all these tussles and massacres. I think that, you know, the American institution and the American leadership, political leadership, by Donald Trump, would have its own final say about the whole situation, being a country of institutions, in addition to the heavy existence of the IBAC and the Jewish lobby, in the interests of all things, of all concerned, actually. The whole scandalous affair will end at one stage, but unfortunately, it would be such a disastrous one. They would select, actually, to put an end and to devastate and to demolish Bashar al-Assad at one stage, as much as they have done of Saddam Hussein at one stage before, but not now, actually. They are expanding and they are taking and seizing the chance to demolish the infrastructure of the Syrian land, to take their own interests of all the fortunes of Damascus, of Aleppo, of all these countries, as much as letting the situation actually to be geographically expanded with the view of establishing the remote interests of the Jewish-Israeli state, so to speak.
Ambassador Shazly, now, you spoke about how really the Arab League or the interference of the Arab states is quite actually absent within the Syrian conflict. Now, would it be not just Egypt among the other Arab states, would it be in the best interest to have Bashar al-Assad still in power? Would it be in their interest to have Syria as one whole country as we've always been used to? Would it be in their interest to have it with its sovereignty, but still with some international interference there? Keeping in mind that there are a lot of divisions within the Syrian people, still a lot of terrorist groups and extremist groups are located in Syria. What do you think would be in the best interest for the Arab states, including Egypt?
First of all, as I said before, I don't think the issue is whether Bashar al-Assad stays or goes. But the issue is to preserve Syria as an intact sovereign state. This is the issue.
Do Arab countries want that?
Personally, I am not really sure of that. There are Arab countries who have ambitions on Syrian territories, unfortunately. There are Arab countries who would prefer to have a divided Syria with some ghettos and some fronts loyal to them, rather than to have a strong, unified Syria. I think this is catastrophic. And this, I mean, this is not the tragedy in itself. The tragedy is that there is no Arab vision for the future. Some Arab leaders and some Arab countries have a very short range view of history. We have been threatened by, since the days of Condoleezza Rice, who was, by the way, in a Republican administration. She is the first person to say chaos, the
creative
chaos. There is no creative chaos. Chaos is chaos. Chaos brings destruction. But it is creative for outside forces. She is the one who said, first spoke of the new Middle East dividing the Arab countries. And this, I mean, will be catastrophic. Because, I mean, you have, since the beginning of the 21st century, Sudan is divided. Iraq is de facto divided. The Kurdish area is completely sovereign now. Mm-hmm. When they go to fighting against ISIS, they raise the Kurdish flag, not the Iraqi flag. Mm-hmm. Syria is in danger of partition. You had the UN envoy going and speaking publicly of dividing Syria. Mm-hmm. You have Libya is threatened. Mm-hmm. Yemen is de facto partitioned. Mm-hmm. Somalia, who everybody forgets that it is an Arab country and member of the Arab League, is partitioned into three or four parts. And what will this lead to? And if you look to history, you will never find that the partition of a country has led to stability. The partition of India into India and Pakistan has led to three wars up to now. The partition of Korea has created one of the most volatile parts in the world. Mm-hmm. The partition of Taiwan from China is creating instability in the South China Sea. Mm-hmm. Every country that Palestine was partitioned, we've been living in war since that time. So you have the issue of partition mm-hmm. has never led to stability. It has led to war, it has led to chaos, it has led to instability.
Yes. Well, Dr. Abdul Halim, two other players really concerned with what's happening in Syria is Turkey and Iran. Now, Turkey has a lot of interest in what's going on in Syria, and actually there was a visit by Turkey's foreign minister Davutoglu last Saturday to Iran, where he met the Iranian president and the foreign minister. And it was conceived that they are trying to send a message to Tehran, knowing that Iran is a strong supporter of Assad. How do you see the involvement of those two parties within the Syrian conflict in light of the recent advances by the Syrian government troops in Aleppo?
Right. So outward seeming, they would seem to be very much mutually identified with each other, that they are sending a little message, actually. But the fact remains that they are working with the view of seizing the chance, actually, to achieve what you might call the war of proxy, or the proxy war, the sort of the fourth generation war, or the fifth, perhaps, so to speak. In addition to the fact that, you know, the expansion of the new Middle East that has been called before the very big Middle East, mm-hmm. now turned into sects and groups, into very much divided border lines. And I would think that Tehran, side by side with Turkey, are very much using and utilizing the suitable chances to have their own ends and ways and advances, actually, within the Syrian land. Mm-hmm. They are very much utilizing all their own powers. To outward seeming, they might be very much, you know, divided among one another, but at the end of the day, they are exchanging weapons with each other, so much mm-hmm. sure that you find among the Turkish soldiers some of the weapons inscribed on them made in Tehran, mm-hmm. in much the same way that the vice versa. So to outward seeming, there is what you might call a sort of tussle, a sort of disparity among all those people. But deep down, they are working as much as they are working with Israel also to mm-hmm. take advances and to take their own deep interests, actually, into the Syrian land.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. Well, ladies and gentlemen, there is a lot of escalating developments regarding the Syrian conflict, with the advances of the government troops, the rebels losing their hold on the two-thirds so far of Aleppo City. We're going to be following up all these developments here on Nile International. But unfortunately, that's all the time we have for this edition of the Daily Debate. But before we go, I'd like to thank our very distinguished guest ambassador, Mohammed the Shazly, the member of the Egyptian Council for Foreign Affairs. I'd also like to thank very much Dr. Mohammed Abdul Halim, the political analyst. Gentlemen, thank you very much
for
joining us
My
this
pleasure.
Evening. Ladies and gentlemen, please stay tuned for more coming up on Nile International. I'm Hani Saif. Thank you for joining us.